What's your date of birth, Bob?
August 12, 25.
With the Florida High School?
Yes.
And did you graduate from high school?
I left school at the end of my junior year. Okay. Because the war started.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan.
I had just shortly had, before I got my driver's license, I was 16 then, and we were just out tooling around looking for girls, probably. And it came over the radio, and we kids, it didn't mean an awful lot to us right at that time. We didn't understand it. You never saw the patriotism that was among the civilians and things like that. It was wonderful. I mean, it did a lot of good in respects like that, you know, because these people that really didn't know what United States was found out in a hurry, and very proud of that, my parents and their generations. But the story that I like to tell, and I've told it many times, that after, this is back when I'm 17, quit school, enlisted with a friend of mine. He and I are the only ones that did that out of the, and the phone rang one day. We weren't going to be called up for 6 weeks or something like that in the Navy. Phone rang, and it was one of my high school teachers. And she said, "Bob, you quit school." I said, "Yeah." "Jim quit school." "Yeah." She said, "Have you already signed up?" And I said, "Yeah." She said, "Well, there's not much." She said, "Right or wrong," she said, "it's done. But I want you to come down to the house tomorrow night at 6:30. I said, "What for?" And she said, "I want you to come down to the house tomorrow night at 6:30. I said, "What for?" "You come down to my house at 6:30 tomorrow. Bring Jim." So down we go. When we got there, she was a history, American history teacher, and the English 4 teacher was there, two of them. And I said, "You guys didn't graduate." "Nope." "Don't you realize what that means?" "Yep." "You're going to graduate." I said, "What do you mean we're going to graduate?" She said, "New York State is holding a special regents in 2 weeks. We're going to cram you in 2 weeks for your senior year." Wow. These two teachers. I said, "I don't know, I didn't say this, but you're out of your mind, you know." She said, "You do that." Those two teachers for 14 nights till midnight, every night, crammed us, and we passed the regents. And I've thought to myself, I respect those two ladies probably as much as any person in my life. I enlisted in the Navy Air Corps at that time. She didn't say, "I want you to go," but she said, "I'm not going to tell you not to go, but I can't sign your papers." Dad said, "I will." I started as an airplane cadet, I mean, I'm a flyer. And I was in that just a short time when they extended the course a full year, and which was going to be 2.5 years of training instead of a year and a half. And I bailed out and went to gunnery school in the regular Navy. One was in Mississippi and one was in New Orleans. But then I picked up the ship, and the ship had just been commissioned, and I wasn't aboard, you know. If you're on board, from the beginning, you're a plank owner, which is quite an honor in the Navy. But I wasn't there. It was commissioned in New England someplace, and it picked us up in New Orleans. Yeah, we went down through the canal and out the Pacific.
So give me a little, could you do some island hopping? And
oh yeah, in the course of the war you hit almost every, you wouldn't hit every island, but you hit every group of islands, and usually at one time or another. And we had a great ship, and they did well.
Pearl Harbor, did you ever see?
Yeah, that was the first stop after we left San Diego. Guadalcanal, we went down to the Solomons, and then just kind of followed the invasions. You did escort duty, and you also, went in ahead of the troops. The Navy was a heck of a good choice. When you watch those guys go over the side and into the big troubles and the filth and the jungles and stuff, and here we are out there eating. It might only be a sandwich, but at least we were eating. And so you really had no complaints. I trained on 3-inch, 4-inch, 5-inch, and 20-millimeter.
Okay.
And 4 inches, I never saw a 4-inch again. They were just being discarded out of the Navy. I started on 20-millimeter and ended up on a 5-inch. Face was greased up and your ears were covered, and did not see a kamikaze. I saw the results of the kamikazes. We were operating with the USS Tennessee battleship, and although I didn't see it, they took a kamikaze and they lost 49 men. And the reason I remember that so well is when they buried the fellas or the side, we, as their escorts, there were two or three battleships came down through and in one direction, and our escorts, we were in pretty safe territory by that time, went the other way, and you could hear the band playing. This is kind of a personal story. Before I left for the Navy, my sister went to Fredonia State for a year, and she brought home a fellow by the name of Russ Burlingham, and Russ played the clarinet. And I got to know him, and he came over to the house a few times. And these 49 guys over the side, when we went by the ship going in the opposite direction during the internment or whatever they called it, they were playing Danny Boy.
Yeah.
And it kind of, was real touching. When I got home, I was working one day, and this guy came in the store, and it was Russ Burlingham. And we get to talking, "Where were you? Where were you?" He said, "Well, I was on the USS Tennessee." He was in the band.
Oh my gosh.
And it was one of the times in the Navy where I really, I guess you might say, tears came to your eyes, because these guys had been lost, Biggest naval battle ever, Leyte Gulf.
October 25th, 1944. Alone off the Philippine coast of Samar, the U.S. Navy's small task unit Taffy 3 is under attack, outnumbered and outgunned by the powerful Japanese Center Force. Admiral Clifton Sprague orders his ill-prepared fleet into action.
And all the ships were in that one. And the ship I was on did themselves some honor there. I had nothing to do with it, but they nailed a cruiser. The strange part of it was, it wasn't any of us in the gunnery department. They got it with a torpedo, carried 10 torpedoes.
Did you guys ever get hit?
Not lethally. We got, you know, shrapnel and small shots, but nothing big. We had no person killed. We had some wounds from shrapnel and things like that. But we actually, we for some of these guys, we all got shot to pieces, you know. We did not. Cards and gambled and stuff like that when we weren't supposed to, a little bit. You didn't have an awful lot of spare time, at least on a gunner, if you were a gunner's mate, because every month you would rotate a four-hour shift, so that, say, this particular month you were on the 8 to 12, that was twice a day, and you still had to, over and above that, be on the guns at daylight and dusk. Mm. So your day was fairly well taken up.
This is the BBC Home Service. We're interrupting programs to make the following announcement. It is understood that in accordance with arrangements between the three great powers, an official announcement will be broadcast by the Prime Minister at 3 o'clock tomorrow. In view of this fact, tomorrow, Tuesday, will be treated as Victory in Europe Day.
Very excited about it, because you knew that there were so many more troops and ships that would be sent to the Pacific. You know, so that it probably would shorten the war in the Pacific.
Our rejoicing is sobered and subdued by a supreme consciousness of the terrible price we have paid to rid the world of Hitler and his evil band. Let us not forget, my fellow American, our victory is but half won. The West is free, but the East is still in bondage to the treacherous tyranny of the Japanese. When the last Japanese division has surrendered unconditionally, then only will our fighting job be done.
And we had Tokyo Rose on every night because she played the beautiful music.
This is your Japanese sister, the voice of truth.
Get Tokyo Rose.
Reaches out to you from the peacefulness of Japan.
She even mentioned our ship on one of, by name, one time, and wasn't true at all. Radio men had her tuned in a good bit of the time, and guys could go up near the radio shack and listen. You know, if you liked music, which I did. Yeah.
Was she? Did you take it for what it was worth? Good music, but she was a propaganda.
Oh, but you knew that it was lie after lie after lie. I mean, what they had done, because you were visibly the ships were there that she said they sunk. You know, and but she had a very, you know, alluring kind of voice. And
that you are making this futile sacrifice for a people who sit snug and secure 11,000 miles away, who have never seen a grenade burst in an American stomach, or an American arm blown from an American shoulder, a people who are not interested in the headlines you try to make. This is the voice of truth. I will be with you again tomorrow, those of you who are left to listen. But this morning, my heart is heavy with
death. All right, you Yankee brothers, you want to live forever? Get the lead out of you.
I got put off of the destroyer June of 1945. because I had enough time and I had no leaves. I was going to be rotated. So they put me and a few other guys ashore on Samar in the Philippines. Well, within a week, a tanker came in from New Orleans, dumped its load, and they had a new gunner's mate on there who they took off and put me on. And we went back. And the story that I was going to tell you is when we hit the canal, on August, I don't know what date, 11th, 12th, 10th, whatever it was, I hadn't been ashore on Liberty in over 2 years. There's no place to go out there unless you got to Australia, which we didn't. And half of the ship was given Liberty. You know, there was port side and starboard side, and you were one or the other. And I don't know how they determined, but I was on the first Liberty in Panama off of this tanker. And we hadn't been ashore more than 2 or 3 hours. And of course, we were in Panama City, and there's a lot of military there. And we were ashore 2 or 3 hours, and this truck came clipping up the road with a loudspeaker on, the war's over.
From the Mutual Newsroom in New York, San Francisco, the International News Service, FCC quotes, Domai saying Japan accepts Allied terms. Repeating this bulletin, dated San Francisco, the Federal Communication Commission quotes Domai saying Japan accepts.
We were in Panama City, just went wild. I mean, just wild. And I was ashore with two other guys. We had more money than we knew what to do with. We had nothing to spend money on for 2 years. I didn't draw money. And so we all had a ton of money. Okay, so we'll go to the best nightclub we can find. So we go to this, three of us went to this nightclub, ordered the most expensive dinners we could get, drank way too much, and the three of us ran up a bill of $140. Well, in 1945, that's a lot of booze and a lot of steak, you know. Well, anyway, there were a lot of people in this nightclub or whatever it was, and one of us, stupid as we were, said, gee, $140, that's a lot of money. What do you say we jump the bill? So we waited till the waiter wasn't around, and we took off. We got up the street a block or two, and one of us, probably not me, I can't remember, said, you know, that waiter might have got stuck with that check, so back we go. And he saw us come, and he said, oh my God, would I live up? Worried about you guys, where you been? And he's, I don't remember what we told him. But anyway, you never saw a guy that was more glad to see three fellas. We gave him $140, and we gave him a $100 tip.
Oh my gosh.
And so that went well. We got back to the ship. And if you could get on the tanker by going up the gangplank, saluting the officer of the day and the ensign. Okay, if you couldn't, they had a cargo net lowered with a boom over there, and they dumped the guys in that and haul them on board. Well, if you couldn't stand up and make those two salutes, you got time in the brig. It might only be a couple hours, but you had.
Were you able to salute, or did you end up in the net?
I was in the net. Don't remember too much about it. They tell me that all that happened anyway. We were heading for New Orleans, and we would have been put off there, but we got into a hurricane, and they pushed us into Mobile, Alabama. So they sent us over by train. We had to Cosmoline all the guns. you know, grease them all up and put them under storage state. And then we went, so I went, they sent me to New Orleans with the other guys. And we no more got there, and of course everything is crazy. We got a 30-day leave. I came home. The end of 30 days, I went back. It was still so crazy down there. I was only there a couple hours. They gave me 14 more days, sent me to Buffalo to report to Buffalo in 14 days to Naval headquarters there. So my mom and dad took me to Buffalo, and we were going to be reassigned. And there was about 100 of us there, and they had us lined up for lunch. I said goodbye to my parents, and they went shopping. I said goodbye to my parents, and anyway, there was 100 of us lined up for lunch. And this bosun mate came along, and he called out three names. And, you know, you got discharged, what they call a point system, and they lowered the points. I can't remember the numbers, but they were 42 or something, and I had 39. And they lowered, the three of us, they lowered the points to 39 that morning. So they pulled us out of line and said, you go home for 4 days and go to Sampson and get discharged.
I'll be there.
That's what we did. And then I went out, my dad and mother, I found their car. They were still shopping. So I went home for the third time.
Oh, okay.
And then came home. The day I got discharged, I hitchhiked home in a snowstorm from Sampson and got in about midnight. Sunday morning I slept in, and Monday morning my dad never went back to work. I mean, I had worked there enough, I knew enough about it that yeah. I took over on Monday morning. You missed probably three of the funnest years in your life, but for a single guy like me, I love the water, I didn't get hurt, and I was probably the biggest coward in the whole Pacific, but I got along good. You know, I have never really sat down and talked with my kids about this.
Mm-hmm.
I really haven't.
I salute you, and I applaud you. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, let me get you unmiked.